looking for that which will last. How much of our time as a people do we waste? And I'm not talking about being lazy or inactive. I'm really talking about a directed, purposeful, useful occupation, because we have only so much time that's given to us on this planet, isn't it? And it goes so quick, you wouldn't believe it. Ask people my age, they'll tell you. The other thing is, we are so busy. Now, I think being too busy really is a choice. It's what you do. Not, you can fall into it, but it is a choice if you continue it. And too busy, too much of anything is, of course, no good. Who is this man? Does anybody know him? Oh, come on, somebody must recognize him. You're kidding. What's he famous for? I'm not preaching to you unless you can tell me. I don't care if you come from another country.
You made the trip to the Antarctic?
Oh, it's a good thing that the man has died. If this ever came to his attention, that's all you knew.
You climbed up the mountain.
Ah, he's saved today. He climbed up Mount Everest. He was the first to climb up Mount Everest. How many of them were there? Did he go by himself? Did he reach the top by himself? And there was another chap there. Now he is famous, he's a New Zealander, he is a mountaineer, he's a philanthropist, that's what he used to be. Great guy. Fit, like me. But it wasn't just him that got on the top of the mountain, that scaled Mount Everest. Who else was it? Nobody ever remembers the other guy. No, you don't, do you? This is him. Tenzing Norgay. He was actually a few years older than him, by about 5 years. He was one of the, well, one of the locals, but a very faithful companion. The two relied on each other tremendously in achieving what they achieved. However, you want to remember that Tenzing Norgay, he was a Sherpa, they called them, locals. When you go to the Himalaya, how many of you have ever been to the Himalaya? I'm not talking about climbing Mount Everest, I'm not asking that. How many of you have ever been to that area? It's fantastic. And the higher you go, the more tired you get. It takes time to acclimatize. And I remember looking when I went a few times to Kashmir and then I traveled further north. And I wanted to get as close as possible to Mount Everest. But when you walk, the oxygen is less, the percentage. It's just, I couldn't believe how it affected me. But there it is. This is about 5 stages. It's very fascinating. I won't talk about it anymore. I just want you to know, there was a failed attempt that they had in 1952. He failed. He failed. It just didn't work out. So he appeared before a people, for a particular, and I forgot now what the occasion was, but he appeared before. Of course, everybody was very interested in what he was trying to do. He was highly respected, Sir Edmund Hillary. And he appeared before a group, and I think it might have been a university, and he put this picture up of Mount Everest. And that in those days would have been those slides, or slide boxes, you understand. And he turned around, before he addressed the people, he turned around and he looked at that picture and he said, Mount Everest, you beat me the first time, but I'm going to beat you the next time. Because you have grown all you are going to grow. But I am still growing. You like that? Mm-hmm. 1 year later, 1953, 29th of May, they still tried again and they beat the mountain. 29th of May, 1953, the same year that they discovered the DNA, Watson and Crick, significant year, 1953. To reach that is incredible. But he had the confidence that he could do it. Now, he believed in himself, and obviously the man or the Tensei that would accompany him. He knew that he'd never give up. Somebody once asked a mountaineer, it wasn't Sir Edmund Hillary, why do you climb that mountain? It was somewhere in Switzerland. And the man said, because it's there. Good enough reason? Life is a bit like climbing mountains. For except we don't do it in our own strength as a Christian. I want to take you to the book of Nehemiah. The Hebrew name Nehemiah means really the Lord comforts. And it's a story that I absolutely love, because I can only sort of take little spots in the book of Nehemiah, but you'll get the gist, and I'm just presuming you have some familiarity with him. He was a contemporary of Ezra, he was a contemporary of Malachi, and he was a cupbearer to Artaxerxes Longimanus, the fairly beneficent toward the Jews Persian ruler, and we'll talk more about it as we go along. If I have to give it a subtitle, I'd give it this subtitle: Change Your World in 52 Days. How about that? Well, he certainly changed Jerusalem in 52 days. Does anybody know why? Just curious. No, you all look the other way and you're not going to give me an answer. That's okay. This is a map that you should be familiar with. The green line, which starts from the district of Babylon, is the journey as it was taken by Zerubbabel and Sheshbazzar, and they were the returnees. They were told by Cyrus to go back to Jerusalem. Now you say, why don't they go straight away that way? Well, this is all desert. It does not support life. If you travel with kids and livestock, that's a sure way to perish. So that's why you would always, Abram did the same. You go along the river Euphrates and then you go down into Palestine. And the Babylonian armies did exactly the same. The Assyrian armies, they used to come from up north, but that is how you traveled if you wanted to go, and that there it is. They were with about 60,000 roughly in round figures. And what did Cyrus tell him to do? Does anybody remember that?
Rebuild the temple.
It was not about rebuilding Jerusalem. It was mainly about rebuilding the temple. Because he had a Bible study with Daniel, who showed him documentation, and Cyrus is no fool. We talked about that last Wednesday. He showed him the documentation from the scroll of Isaiah, chapter 44-45, named 100 years before he was born, told how he would take the city. He thought it was his idea. No, it was God's idea. And also, he was going to send them back without cost to rebuild the temple. And that's exactly what he did do. But that's not the topic for today. Now, we, about 100 years later, slightly less, you have this route here taken by a smaller group of people, and they risk a little bit of the desert. It's not too bad up north. And what they do from there, they go to Jerusalem, and that is the route that was taken by Ezra and Nehemiah. Now Ezra goes about 12 years before Nehemiah goes. I want you to understand something. Ezra and Nehemiah have never seen Jerusalem. They haven't been in Judea. They were born and bred down here. And I put it to you that perhaps 94-95% of the people that went with Zerubbabel there in 538, probably a little, about 537, 536, that's when they left. And there are different dates here. They came in two groups. So none of those would have been actually born in Judea. You understand? Judea is down here. I want you to understand that if you were born and bred here, a highly developed civilization, to go back home to rebuild or build, it's quite a challenge because everything was in ruin. In the year 586 BC, everything was destroyed there, the city, Jerusalem, the temple. Now the temple was rebuilt and rededicated in 516 BC. So when we come to the days of Ezra and Nehemiah, now you understand, you start counting down if it's BC. Everybody's clear on that. Now you understand that these people did not go back to rebuild the temple, it was rebuilt. You understand that? This was the fascinating one is 457, when Ezra goes back, because he has the particular letter which has a contents which in the book of Daniel was referred to from the command to rebuild and restore Jerusalem. There's two things: rebuilding Jerusalem and restoring Jerusalem as a city. And you go to the seventh chapter of the book of Ezra, you get a beautiful description of that. Fascinating. Okay, everybody clear on that? And if it's something you don't understand, I don't mind if you ask me. Because that's the situation. The year that we're dealing with here is 444 BC. And it is about rebuilding the wall, primarily. And if you have rebuilt the wall, it serves a purpose to put the gates in, but you have to put the gates in. Otherwise the wall is not functioning. Are you with me? Yeah? All clear? Now what happens? When they went back earlier, be it almost 100 years before, and certainly when they went under Ezra, the whole thing is that they would have restored the wall to some degree. And the terrible thing is, there was animosity with the local people, and it led to this information that Nehemiah received, Nehemiah being on a very different place. Let me just go back. I think I might just want to tell you. Do you see that name Susa there? Well, that's the location where he, at this stage, was as he was serving to King Artaxerxes Longimanus. This was a winter palace. You only go there in the winter northern hemisphere. You don't go there in the summer. It's unbearably hot. Probably a little bit like the Philippines where I'll be in a fortnight. So. They had no roof. There was no roof in the palace because it never rained. You understand? Okay. And he learns from his own people that the survivors who are left from the captivity in the province, that is in the province of Judah, of course, are there in great distress and reproach because of this. The wall of Jerusalem is also broken down. Broken down by who? Well, the enemies that were locals, and I'll list them in a minute. They were very anti-Jews. And its gates are burned with fire. So you have a city that is unprotected. Are you with me? And this is bad news. This was terrible news, this was sad news, that really affected Nehemiah. And so what do? When you get bad news? Well, you get on your knees, don't you? That's what you do. So he prays for his people, and it begins with a burden. And his burden is the restoration of Jerusalem. His burden is to rebuild that wall. His burden is to hang the gates. Because he knows the importance of that. A city without a wall and a gate is not a city. We pray, keep faith with God. We remain steadfast and faithful to the end. Now here is something about Nehemiah that you need to know. It is not how you start, though it's important, but that's not the essence. The essence is really how you finish that counts most, isn't it? Folks, does that get through? That's true. That's very true. Now, he's the cupbearer to the king. Now you'd say, well, that's an ordinary job. No, 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 no. If you were the cupbearer to the king, you were a confidant of the king. These kings, like Artaxerxes Longimanus, who had a very long reign, feared one thing, that they will be replaced. Somebody would want them out of the way. There were always those who wanted to. And a very common way to bump off a king, if you couldn't do it militarily, you poisoned them, you see. Poisoning was a very common methodology of getting rid of someone you didn't like. And a cupbearer would make sure that before he would serve it to the king, that it was kosher, so to speak. And so he would taste of it himself. It reminds me of a little job I once had. I shouldn't admit to it, but I will. I had this job and for catering, and I remember having to serve alcohol. This is in the pre-Advent days, which is a long time ago. And I thought it was the most boring job in the world. And it started with the leftovers before you go to the kitchen. And then it started, I better taste this first. And I was very short-lived at that job. And I disliked alcohol thereafter. Approval of the king. So the king looks at him and the king says, oh, you look terrible. You look sad. And he comes out and says, in fact, the Bible says he had a prayer before he answered the king. One of those quick prayers. One of those quick prayers, you know, you have to pray. And you know what? Those prayers are the most intent and they work. They actually work. And so that's what he did. And the king granted him to a leave of absence. He could go back. He could go back there to help his people in Jerusalem. The king was very kindly disposed towards Nehemiah, because he knew he was a man of great integrity. So Nehemiah makes requests, and the king grants the request. In fact, he gets letters of authority, not just to move through the territories, but he also gets supplies. He can help himself to supplies, and that is fantastic. So he's on his way, and he arrives in Jerusalem, and the year is 444 BC. And one of the first things that he does, he at night time, he gets a few people that he can trust, and he inspects the wall. And I put it to you that is a very prudent thing to do. You know, people say, oh, God will do it. No, 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 he's using you to do it. And I think it's always very good to look at any undertaking and make an accurate assessment for as much as is possible. By all means, pray first. Pray for discernment, but then look what is expected of you. And so he sees the broken down walls, the burned gates. And this book of Nehemiah is not enough studied. It has many, many, many names. If you want to learn or see a lot of Hebrew names, go to the book of Nehemiah. He lists all the people that are coming with him. And then he also lists all the people who were participating in rebuilding the wall and hanging the gates. Now you say, what does that have to do with me in 2019? Why would I read through all that names? It is no different than when you go to a war memorial and you see all the names of the ones that have fallen. They did something extraordinary. Can I put it to you, it is a list of honor in the book of Nehemiah, honoring those who gave their service to the very best they could do to build the wall of Jerusalem and to hang the gates. These people should not be forgotten. So, he calls a meeting. After he knows what he sees and what has to be done, he calls a meeting of everybody. And then he says, it comes down to this, because I can only hop through this book too quickly. Let us rise and rebuild. There is an enthusiasm, there is a willingness, they're going to get together and they are going to rebuild the wall and hang the gates. Now, when you decide to do something, particularly something right, particularly something for God, expect criticism. Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite, and Geshem the Arab, they were the three main identities that were a threat to the Jewish people that had returned, and in particularly now to Nehemiah, because they hated them. And so when they heard of it, they laughed at them. There is nothing more discouraging than somebody laughs at you, belittles you, and makes you feel that small. Isn't that right? That's a real test. But please, ignore that. All participated in the work. If you look at the list of the people involved, they all had their portion to do. It is a magnificent description of a church doing a great work for God. If you don't learn from that, you'll learn from nothing. You're unteachable. So the wall had to be defended against the enemies. But everybody that participated knew that they were working for that which would last. They knew. So you get your criticism. In fact, you will get the distractions. If Satan can't discourage you by belittling or insulting or by criticism, he'll try distractions. I think I have a comment of C.S. Lewis on here in a minute. Hostility. People will oppose you. You set out to do a work for God. You have hostility to overcome. A compelling compulsion to continue. What hallmarked those people, what really secured the blessing, is that they had a compelling compulsion to continue. Constant challenging in doing the work of God. He knew, and this is where you can be sure of success, he knew God was going to be in it. If God is in it, what you do, you will be blessed. You will succeed. Now the wall restored. The wall restored. Despite discouragements, so he says, we built the wall and the entire wall was joined together. Now, you got to understand that it's only half the height. Are you with me? I haven't got a measurement for you. I don't know how high the wall was at the time. But it's only half the height. But it will do the job. It perhaps took another decade or so to obviously another few years to build it to the full height. And they would have done that. So up to half its height, I don't know how long it takes. We have no archaeological evidence. But what you can do when you have gotten this far, you can hang the gates. And you start controlling what comes in and what goes out. Are you with me? You have a protection of what is precious for you inside that city, namely the temple and everything else. For the people, I love this statement, for the people had a mind to work. What you look for, not just as a pastor, but you look for people who have a mind to work. Not how can I get through the day. No, no, no. A zeal for the work. That is what was there. And that made him so strong, working together. And he encouraged his people against the enemies. He said, don't be afraid of them, the enemies. Do not be afraid. Remember the Lord, great and awesome. You know, and it's good that we should do that towards each other too. Whenever anybody gets discouraged, remember how great God is. Please, God is bigger than the problem. There's a reformation on the social reform, on the social injustice. Some of them that had returned, particularly the early ones, had acquired fields, lands, houses, and they were actually using the people to work for them. They're charging them interest and in all sorts of ways. And the people that are working, obviously, for rebuilding the wall and hanging the gates, they say to Nehemiah, we can't keep this up. We have families to feed. There's a lot of rubble to get rid of. And you know, Nehemiah deals with those who have lined their pockets. You know, there are always people who know how to make money out of people. And they're regarded as the clever people, but they're the furthest away from the kingdom of heaven. You need to understand that. And he approaches them. He lines them up and he talks to them. He says, restore to them, that's the ones that don't have, even this day. Don't do it tomorrow, now. He says, give them back their lands, give them back their vineyards, their olive groves, and their houses. Do you know what? That's exactly what they did do. You wouldn't like to try that in most churches, would you? But that's how strong the sentiment was, the willingness was, the desire was to serve God. When it gets that strong, personal possessions are not anything to be desired. A reform was effected. And therefore the work for God could proceed much better, much more efficient. And it did. Then ultimately, there is a conspiracy against Nehemiah. Sanballat Geshem sent to me saying, he said that in chapter 6, come let us meet together to the villages of the plain of Ono. Now that's about 20 miles northwest of Jerusalem. Not far away, but enemy territory. But they thought to do me harm. I like that. The discernment of Nehemiah was second to none. He understood. You know, four times they approached him. Four times they wanted to talk to him, try to draw him away. But I love this statement, and this should be a statement to everybody who is willing to work for God. I am doing a what? A great work, so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave and go down with you? Nothing could distract him. You want to take a leaf out of this book of Nehemiah. You know, have you ever noticed whenever you have your religious observations, going to church, contributing to church, or even your Bible study, there's always something that will distract you. That means Satan has not given up on you. So you make sure you tell him, I'm doing a great work. I'm not going anywhere else. Faithfulness is what Jesus is looking for in us. Discernment, a little story. True story, I don't know the man's name, a missionary to China. That's what he wanted to do. He wanted to be a missionary to China. And so he did. He was exceptionally bright. He had a capacity for organizing. He had a capacity for evaluation and applications for solutions. It was recognized by a number of companies. And one particular company desired his services. And they sent him a letter of invitation to work for them. Good salary, good friends benefits, good terms, and he knocked it back. And then within a very short time, they sent him another letter, double the salaries. You should have seen the friends benefits, conditions, whatever. Whatever he wanted, and he knocked it back. A third time they tried. And when he knocked that back, they said to him, next they went and saw him, what's wrong? Why don't you want to take it? This is what he said, I like this. It's not your salary that is too little. It is the work, it's the job that is too small. You like that? That man had a vision, and he was a very successful, apparently, missionary. Then Sanballat sent one of his servants to me as before. So the fifth attempt to distract him. But this one is very nasty. An open letter in his hand. Now the open letter, normally a letter would be sealed, it's like a scroll. This one was open. So the guy who brings the letter does this as he walks along. Oh, that's interesting. Can you imagine? And in that letter there are certain accusations which he will pass on. It's an open letter, you see. And it was intentionally an open letter. And it accuses Nehemiah, you are rebuilding the wall that you may be their king. So you will rebel against your overlord, Artaxerxes Longimanus. You will build the wall so you can fight and protect your city. And you want to proclaim yourself king. Have you ever been falsely accused? Let me ask you a question. Have you? No? They've been that nice to you? A rumor does not have to give a source. It's fake news, Donald Trump would say. Yeah? If it goes viral, everybody believes it. Do you know that? Everybody believes it. You can't defend against gossip. Gossip is like a cancer that's aggressive. It eats in the community. God hates the pointing of the finger, which is an expression for gossip. There's a little old lady, and she doesn't like her pastor. So much so does she dislike him that she decides to tell a few stories. Gossip. No foundation, particularly, but that's what she does. Now he's aware of it, and he doesn't do anything about it. And so she continued for quite a while, quite nasty things, really. And sometime shortly later, she gets ill. She's sick, real sick. So what does she do? Well, she calls for the pastor. And he comes. And she asks him if he wants to pray with her, and he says a prayer, and he pleads to God for to restore this lady. And after the prayer, she said, I have a confession to make. She said, you know, I've done said some terrible things about you. I'm so sorry. Can you please forgive me? He said, yes, I can. He said, but when you are well, I want you to come and see me. And I want you to bring a basket. Just a basket. And I want you to have a pillow that is filled with feathers, right? You come and see me when you're well. So after some weeks he was restored, continued prayer, and praise God, there she is. And she comes and sees the pastor with the basket and the pillow and the feathers. And he says to the little lady, now this is what I want you to do. I want you to put all the feathers out of the pillow, discard that, and put them in the basket. And I want you to go around town and put the village, whatever, township. And I want you to spread out those feathers. And she says, yes, I will do that, but why do you want me to do that? He said, and then I want you to come back and show me the empty basket. Please do it. She goes out and she does that, because she comes back with the empty basket. She said, why did you want me to do that? He said, now I want you to go back and pick up every feather and make sure there's not one missing. She said, I can't do that. The wind would have carried them away. And he said, that's exactly what gossip does. Do you understand that? The allegory here. That is what gossip does. You cannot correct it. It sticks. And that is the lesson that he gave to the little lady. But there you are. I think it's a good one. Now, Ezra reads the law. And that's good. The Feast of Tabernacles, that is in the autumn, northern hemisphere, probably about October. The people confess their sins. They humble themselves before God. The Sabbath is upheld. There are Phoenician traders trying to sell the Jewish community things. And they are warned by Nehemiah. He said, tell his captains, he said, you tell those people, they keep fronting up here on the Sabbath, I'll put them in jail. And of course they disappeared. So what we have a condition where the wall is and the gates are restored and the law is restored. That's fantastic. That is great. This is really a great story. Working for that which lasts, I like what Jesus said. Seek what? First, the kingdom of God. And whose righteousness should you be looking for? You better get this right. It's not your righteousness, it's his righteousness. Your righteousness is not getting you over the line. It is his righteousness. And all these things, whatever you need, shall be added to you. So you work for that which will last. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Make sense? What will a man give in exchange for his soul? Just two slides more, a couple of slides. I don't know what the name is of that person, but that person wrote this. I like this. I want you to have a look at this. This is good. When I was young, all my prayer to God was, Lord, give me the energy to change the world. And he says, at the middle age and realizing that my life was half gone without me changing a single soul. Get it? He said, I changed my prayer to this. Lord, give me the grace to change all those who come in contact with me. So that is my family and those are my friends. Yeah? And I'll be satisfied. I will be satisfied. I love the next bit. Now that I'm an old man and my days are numbered, I have begun to see how foolish I have been. He says, my one prayer now is this. Lord, give me the grace to change who? That's it. And the last sentence is a blinder. He says, if I had prayed for this right from the start, I would not have wasted my life. What's the essence of that story? God can't use you unless you are willing to change. You can pray for it, he's not going to give it to you. If you are not willing to change yourself, you're not going to change anybody else. It's the moral of the story. That's what the Judeans had to go through. C.S. Lewis, like C.S. Lewis. He's very bright man, very bright man. Good preacher. He said this, for the devil, of course, on the basis of when we're busy, the safest road to hell, because that's what they used to believe in, is the gradual one. The gentle slope, the soft underfoot, so easy and pleasant to walk that path. Without sudden turnings, it doesn't hurt. And he said, without milestones, no signs, no nothing, without milestones, without signposts, he says, he wants those who reject their need for Jesus to realize they are wrong. Now, let me reread that. He wants those who reject their need for Jesus to realize that they are wrong, note this, only when they stand before the Lord in judgment, when it's too late. There's a lot of truth in what he says. We may not have a similar doctrine, but it's very good. It's very, very thoughtful. And so, working for that which lasts, that's our conclusion. In the case that you have selected? This is the question that has to be put. Can you honestly ask God to bless your path and give you success? Yeah? More. Can you honestly get on your knees and ask God to help you accomplish your goal for whose glory? Will it glorify? Not glorify you. That's not the question. Him. Let me ask for three pungent questions. And they're good questions, I think. If you get to where you are going, so you have your ambition, you're pursuing your ambition, you may be at times too busy, you're busy. Let's say you do to the glory of God, surely you are. But when you get to where you're going, you have to ask those three questions. Where will you be? Where will you really be when you have achieved what you want to achieve? Here's another question. If you accomplish your goals, what will you really have? A good job, a good position, the properties that you wanted, maybe the people that you wanted, the relationship that you wanted. Question still stands. If you accomplish your goals, what will you have? Will you have eternal life? In fact, let me put it another way. Are the things that you are living for worth Jesus dying for? And that's a question you have to answer. May God bless you. Heavenly Father, this is earnestly our prayer this morning, that we may see you for who you are and ourselves for what we are. We need you so much in our daily life. Help us with discernment that we make the right choices. Give us the power, the energy to pursue, which we know that will glorify your name. Give us this desire to glorify you. Help us to do that. And Lord, as we embark upon whatever we do, that we can feel that you are in it. We know you are in it. You know, we know you're with us because we know we are doing a great work. Help us to work together to your honor and glory. Bless us. So Lord, bless also the food that we are about to partake. We thank you for it, for those who are willing to prepare. Fellowship, thank you for the friendships and the fellowship that we have as a people here. It's a true blessing. Be with each and every one of us also in the afternoon. In Jesus' most precious name. Amen.